With the recent rise of NFTs, crypto, DeFi, and particularly virtual land, a question that seems to arise more and more is whether or not the lofty goals supporting these ideas are possible to achieve long term. So stick around while we talk about the feasibility of a metaverse. What is up, guys? Welcome back to the Bull Combo. I hope you guys are doing great. I hope you're all having a fantastic day. Today, we're going to be talking about the feasibility of achieving a metaverse, what's currently available, and some of the hurdles that'll need to be overcome in order to get to that point. But before we get started, as always, a few things to get through real quick. If you want to support the channel in any way, you can do so just by using any of the options down below, or by liking the video, subscribing to the channel, and hitting that bell to get notified when I post new content. All right, guys, so as you recall, I started a giveaway a week ago where I was going to be giving away some NFTs. I let you guys know to comment on the video, and I'd be giving away two NFTs. Well, I decided to be a little extra generous today, so I'm actually going to be selecting three winners. So without any further delay, give a huge shout out and a big congratulations to Cowboy Boots Travel, Miles Kogan, and Frody Nilsson. Congratulations, you three. You all won an NFT. So in order to claim this, guys, what I need you to do is I need you to go ahead and sign up for a Wax Wallet. You can see the page here. I also have the URL listed here. You go to that page, sign up for a Wax Wallet. It's literally like a 2-second process. Once you've gotten a Wax Wallet address, feel free to reach out to me on Twitter or on Discord. Send me your address and I'll send the NFT over to you. It's a pretty easy claiming procedure. The longest part of the process really is just about creating an NFT wallet on the Wax blockchain to begin with. All right, guys, so I'm gonna be doing another giveaway, but I'm not gonna start the giveaway until Friday during my weekly update. And I'm gonna try to start running them from there, as I think it makes a little more sense to do it in the weekly update videos, especially since I can't always guarantee I'm going to do a video on Tuesday, since these are Earth 2 focus videos, and sometimes there's not a lot of content to focus on. So I intend on always doing the weekly update videos no matter what. And I feel like it makes just a little bit more sense to start running the giveaways there, since there's no risk of those ever being canceled, delayed, postponed, etc. So definitely look out for the video I post on Friday with our weekly update, and you'll have a chance to win some more NFTs, guys. All right, guys, so let's jump right into the topic of today's video. And this is honestly a pretty big topic right now for a number of reasons. Not only is NFTs and virtual land and the whole crypto space really exploded over the past 3 months, it's a really big deal right now, but there's also been some things that have been called into question recently about the Earth 2 platform, its feasibility, as well as just the feasibility of a metaverse in general. And I thought it was a really good time to sit down and talk about what kind of technology is available right now and how possible it is to achieve a metaverse, whether it be similar to Ready Player One or otherwise. So let's jump right in. So the first thing we should probably do is do a little bit of a refresher on what the definition of a metaverse is, because I think this is really important. So a metaverse, by definition, is a virtual reality space in which users can interact with the computer-generated environment and other users. So it sounds pretty similar to Ready Player One, but at the same time, it's also important to keep in mind that this sounds very similar to almost every online game that's available at the moment. So while we can get excited about the potential of creating a metaverse, it's very important that we be specific on what type of metaverse we're referring to here, because clearly the word metaverse is a very broad term that can define a lot of different game experiences. So for all intents and purposes in this video, the idea we're going to be focusing on is a metaverse most similar to Ready Player One, a scenario in which there's a very large reactive world hosting hundreds or maybe even thousands of users within the same spot at the same time. So now that we've got the definition of a metaverse down, a good starting point from here is probably to take a look at some of the existing platforms that meet the criteria of a metaverse and how they do come in all shapes and sizes. So we have the OG metaverse that is Second Life, but then we have some of the more traditional modern metaverses that are aiming to be created, like The Sandbox and Decentraland. And I think those three are probably the big three when it falls into what people have come to know and expect from a metaverse, at least from a future perspective. But we also have social metaverse platforms like Facebook Horizon, which basically has a goal of taking the Facebook platform from a social media platform to a VR style social media platform where people can engage not just on a wall or on a timeline, but in a 3D world with a more physical and visceral experience. And they are already pretty far into this. Alpha testing went live last summer. I actually have an Oculus Quest 2 and I'm on the wait list to be included in this. So I'm really hoping that they open this up to me soon, because I'd love to get in there and start building a world in Facebook Horizon, because I think this particularly highlights some of the future potentials we could see with metaverses. Then we have large scale platforms that are more MMO or sandbox style platforms, things like WoW or even Rust, where they have guided storylines, but also involve large amounts of player counts at the same time. So it's a bit of a combination between the two. But not only do we have the standard metaverses like that, as well as the potential future metaverses being worked on, but we have other game platforms that resemble metaverses in less of a traditional sense. And these are games that we probably all play, but don't really realize fit the mold or definition of a metaverse. And these are games like Fortnite, Call of Duty, specifically Call of Duty Warzone, or even Battlefield. These games have large servers. We're talking about 100 players plus in a server in many of these instances, all interacting in the same world. So by definition, that also meets the terms of a metaverse. I can tell you right now, when I'm coming up against a hacker in Warzone, I don't feel like I'm living the metaverse experience. That said, it technically falls into the definition of it. So I think there's just a lot of things that we can look at that already lend themselves well to a metaverse being possible. I think what we really need to look at is our personal definition of a metaverse, and then taking a look at whether or not that is feasible. So for this conversation, I'm going to be talking about something closer to Ready Player One, a more full-on enveloping metaverse, and what would need to be done in order to get to that point. So one major thing that you see when it comes to metaverses in general is discussions regarding server limitations. Now, server limitations are a tricky thing to discuss because games can be built on different server types, and that server type will heavily dictate the capabilities and the functionality of the game. So the general rule of thumb for performance from a server perspective is 20 users for 1 gigabyte of RAM, 1 gigabyte of performance RAM within the game server. So that can be larger or smaller, and it really depends on a few things: the users, the amount of customized content, the amount of objects, and the size of the world that they're existing in. All of those things will play a part in how you experience the application and the performance that you can expect from it. But what this does tell us is that a metaverse, especially at the level of Ready Player One, would require huge amounts of server capacity. Now, that's not to say that something like that's not already been done or isn't already possible. A few years back, the game World of Tanks broke the record for the most concurrently active users within a single server, with 192,000 users active within their RU2 server at the exact same time. 192,000 users is pretty impressive. I know World of Tanks isn't the most graphically intensive game, but it's also not a 2D scroller either, so there's a little bit to be said for that. Another slightly different example of a game being able to house thousands of users under a single server is EVE Online. Now, EVE Online has a single server that supports up to 300,000 users. From what I understand, they have experienced server issues in the past because it seems like whenever they create a server with a certain amount of load, almost instantly that load is surpassed, almost on purpose by the user base. Nevertheless, their servers are able to handle a very impressive amount of people online at the same time. I find this particularly interesting because I think EVE Online is much more similar to something like Earth 2 in the sense that it's an extremely large world with a bunch of customized content all being hosted within the same area. That to me seems particularly impressive. So I think technologies like that just kind of show that while we don't see it all the time, there are game platforms capable of housing or holding an extremely large number of users on a platform or on a given server. So let's say the Earth 2 team is working on building this metaverse. What kind of solutions would they have? What kind of options would they have available to them? Well, let's take a look at those. First, we have the large scale options. Things like large dedicated servers, something similar to EVE Online, World of Tanks, or the still in development Dual Universe, which I know the Earth 2 team has taken a particular level of interest and influence from. We could see the team opt for peer-to-peer servers when they release Phase 2, as these are very popular with RTS style games, though they don't come without their limitations and drawbacks. Mainly peer synchronization, which basically requires the peers to communicate with each other, which in turn does limit the number of players that can be on a given server. And this peer-to-peer communication and synchronization can sometimes fall out of whack, which can lead to user lag and other user experience issues when with inside the platform or inside the game. So while that is one option, it wouldn't be a long-term option. It may be something that would work for a Phase 2 version of the platform, but it definitely wouldn't be a Phase 3 option. So another option would be smaller scale servers. Obviously, this wouldn't allow for hundreds of thousands of users to be all in the same world or in the same server at the same time, but would still allow for a more scalable solution to do something now. So it doesn't seem very appealing for 100 users or less to be standing in front of a piece of property you owned. But if there was 20 or 30 or 50 of the same server for that given area, that does allow a pretty large amount of individuals to visit something at the same time. Even if they aren't all able to interact with each other, that still allows for a huge level of engagement from a user perspective. So I do think that there are options that they can utilize both from a small scale and from a large scale perspective that would make something feasible right now. Now there's another piece of technology that I think is pretty interesting that teams like the Earth 2 dev team could be looking at implementing, and that is procedural generation. So basically what procedural generation is, computer generated terrain or environment based on a series of constraints or rules that the developers put in. So in this specific situation, let's say we're using Earth 2 as the example, the devs would take all of the constraints or the rules for the specific terrain that needs to exist. It could be something like obey this topographical map or this type of topographical map data that's existed in a coding form or in a development form, something like that. And then they let the system loose. They let the engine loose and they say, okay, as long as you follow these rules, go ahead and generate the terrain. Procedural terrain generation obviously saves a lot of time from a development perspective, but it's also something that's kind of important from a performance perspective, because procedural generation can basically focus on things that the user or individual users are looking at rather than having to generate the entire world that exists all at once. Procedural generation works very well from a performance perspective because it doesn't render things that are out of sight, or it doesn't render things in high quality that are too far away for the user to actually look at detail on. So there's a lot of different things, a lot of different corners that it cuts and from a performance perspective to achieve that goal. And I do think that procedural generation is something that the Earth 2 team could be looking at implementing to help with the generation of the terrain, at least within the world itself. There will be a lot of things they have to customize to make this a terrain that can be customized by the users and engaged with by multiple users, but I do think that the framework is there. So is this Ready Player One? I think that's the big question that some people ask themselves when they look at the Earth 2 platform. Can Ready Player One be accomplished? Is this something that we can do right now? And I think that the answer is a little bit more complex, because I think that while Ready Player One, as it stands, and the Oasis that was shown in there, it's probably a couple years away, it's also really important that the platform be developed now and be ready to scale to that point when the technology becomes available. I'm gonna give you an example here. If you have two companies, one that is leveraging every piece of existing technology to create a metaverse that's as possible as it can be, and you have another company that waits until all the features are eventually available before they build their metaverse, which company do you think is going to be successful? I would argue heavily that the company that already had their foot in the door, that had their feet wet, that had the platform ready to go, that had the proactive scalability in mind, and had these later features in mind already, is probably going to be more successful than the company that waited until everything was available before they started anything. So while it doesn't make sense right now for a company necessarily to start down this path from a user perspective, especially from someone non-technical, it makes a lot of sense from the proactive perspective, from the perspective of setting yourself up to be successful and to take advantage of those features when the time comes. So remember, guys, the Earth 2 team's always spoken of a phased release, and that hasn't changed. And that really will be what we're going to see with most aspects of this platform, as well as all the other metaverse platforms out there. Remember, Earth 2 is not the only one doing this, guys. Decentraland's doing this. The Sandbox is doing this. My neighbor Alice is doing this. These are all different style metaverses with different style experiences that are leveraging different technology to accomplish their goals. So they all have similar goals. They're all using different technology to do it. And I think the Earth 2 team is going to fall very much in line with that. Do they have their work cut out for them? Absolutely. Can we expect Ready Player One tomorrow or even next year? Probably not. But can the dev team develop a game that's both engaging and exciting and enjoyable with a lot of replay value that fits the definition of a metaverse? Absolutely, because there's already platforms and games out there that do that. So I think it's a little ridiculous to hear that the Earth 2 idea itself isn't possible, because there's so many different ways they could execute this. And really the only thing it would go against is someone's personal expectation of what they thought it was. So if you're going by the definition of a metaverse, guys, yes, it's 100% possible. If we're going by the definition of Ready Player One, is that possible right now? I would say no, but I would also argue that in the next 5 years, the technology is going to be available for us to create something like that. So is the Earth 2 team obviously hedging their bet on the future? Of course, all of us are here, but that's what a lot of dev teams do, and that's what a lot of very ambitious projects do. So from that perspective, it's nothing out of the ordinary. But ultimately, guys, what I really wanted this to be was just a high-level overview of the functionality and features that are out there right now, what falls in line with the definition of a metaverse, and how, while the Earth 2 team might not be able to build the full Ready Player One comparison everyone would like to see and that they've spoken of, it is within the realm of possibility long-term. And it's still very realistic for them to create an extremely engaging metaverse experience while they work to that point. I just wanted to talk about this, guys, kind of highlight some of those points. I'm curious to hear what you guys have to say. Do you guys think that the dev team's capable of pulling this off? Do you think the Earth 2 team can do this? Do you think this is way too ambitious? Do you think they bit off way more than they can chew? I'd love to hear your comments down below, so let me know down there what you guys think. Other than that, guys, I want to thank you for checking out this video. If you like this video, make sure to hit that thumbs up button. If you like this content you're seeing here, make sure to subscribe and hit the bell to get notified. NFTs, blockchain, virtual land, guys, these are the videos I come at you with every week. And if you like that kind of stuff, I'd love for you guys to hang out and check out more of it. So again, guys, thanks for checking this video out. I hope you guys have a fantastic day, a great afternoon. And until next time, we'll see you soon.